I was reading a blog this week about a book that was published 5 or 6 years ago, and the book was called The Island of the Lost Maps. It was written by a guy named Miles Harvey, and in the book he tells the mostly true story of a map thief named Gilbert Bland, and Bland would travel across America and visit libraries and cut valuable maps out of antique books, and then he would sell those maps. And Miles Harvey, as he was telling about what motivated him as an author to tell this story of a thief who stole maps, here's what he says. He says, in my 30s, I spent a great deal of time at a traveler's cafe in Chicago whose walls were adorned with masks from Bali and whose shelves were filled with maps and guides of far-flung destinations. He says, at that time, I was the literary critic for the magazine Outside Magazine. It was a great job, but one that was beginning to wear on my patience. He says, the books I read were all about people who did things like climb the Himalayan mountains or rode a bicycle across Africa or sailed wooden boats across the Atlantic or tracked into restricted areas of China. And he says, these tales of adventure filled my days and my imagination, yet my own life was anything but adventurous. He writes, the interior of the coffee shop was ringed with clocks, each one showing the time of some distant locale. And as I watched the weeks ticking away in these distant places, I began to long for an adventure of my own. You reach a place where you get tired of reading other people's stories. You want to be able to tell your own story. You get tired of just looking at maps. At some point, you want to go visit the place. And he says that he reminded himself of a character in Joseph Conrad's novel who would look at maps and would say, when I grow up, I'll go there. Someday, I'm going to go there. And for many of us, we can resonate with that feeling of sitting in a coffee shop and seeing other people's adventures and wanting an adventure of our own. We become content to just look at maps and say, someday I'll go there. Well, why not today? Well, today's not a really good day. It's busy right now, but someday I'll go there. Someday I'm going to be more intentional with my marriage. I know what kind of husband I want to be. I know what kind of wife God wants me to be. And someday I'm going to go there, but right now there's just a lot going on. Now, someday I'm going to go there as a parent. Someday I'm going to go there in my neighborhood and in my community. Someday I'm going to accept a challenge to really serve and love where I am. Someday I'm going to do that. But right now, there's just a lot of responsibilities. It's just difficult for me right now because there's so much happening, a lot on my plate. We have all kinds of reasons why we become content for life in the coffee shop. We become content to stare at maps rather than to go on an adventure. And it seems to mark our culture more and more. If you look at the amount of hours we spend watching reality TV, it's pretty staggering. And so people will say, hey, I don't really have time to engage in this or in that, but if you engage them in some kind of conversation about The Voice or American Idol or Keeping Up with the Kardashians or The Bachelor or Dancing with the Stars, then they're very knowledgeable. And we don't see the irony, right? That we can spend so much time watching other people live their lives that we are missing out on an opportunity to live a life and to live our own adventure. And so for all of you who begin this year sitting in the coffee shop staring at maps, what we want to do in the next 4 weeks is invite you to go on an adventure with God. The series we're calling Next is a challenge to you, to all of us, to take the next step in our journey of faith. Because without meaning to, we can become quite content, just trying to maintain the status quo, just staying where we've been spiritually. And for some of us, you can look back maybe a year or two or 5 or 10 years, and nothing's really changed. Like, you've not really been challenged in any dramatic way. There hasn't been any story really worth telling. You've just kind of gone along day to day, week to week. And what we would love to do is to be a church full of explorers that accept the invitation to go on this adventure with God. One of the ways that we're trying to help engage this as a church is through our Love Where You Are groups. And there are groups meeting all around this community. No doubt there's a group meeting close to where you live. And we're asking you to join a Love Where You Are group so that we can not just come to church and sit and listen, but that we can really live this out. We can put the maps away and go on an adventure. And so if you haven't signed up for one of those groups, we'd love for you to do that this weekend. But we don't want to be people who just read others' stories. We want to be able to tell our own. So what I want us to do in the next few minutes is look at the invitation that Jesus gives the disciples to go on adventure with him, to follow him. And what we're going to do is we're going to look at the same story from two different accounts. We're going to look at it from Matthew's perspective, and we're going to see what Luke has to say about it. Same story, but two different perspectives. Matthew chapter 4, we're going to spend some time there. Then we'll flip over and look at Luke chapter 4 and 5 as Jesus invites the disciples to take this next step to follow him. So just some context here. Matthew is writing to a mostly Jewish audience. And because of that, there's a lot he can leave out. There's some cultural assumptions that he can make because his audience understands the perspective that he's writing from. There's some things he doesn't need to include. So when Matthew tells about the calling of the disciples, what you'll notice is it's a pretty succinct version. It's just a few sentences long, really. And then Luke's going to give us more detail. But here's what Matthew says about when Jesus called the disciples to follow him. It says, one day, verse 18, one day, as Jesus was walking along the shore of the Sea of Galilee, he saw two brothers, Simon, also called Peter, and Andrew, throwing a net into the water, for they fished for a living. And Jesus called out to them, come, follow me, and I'll show you how to fish for people. Verse 20 says, they left their nets at once, or immediately, and they followed him. A little farther up the shore, he saw two other brothers, James and John, sitting in a boat with their father, Zebedee, repairing their nets, and he called them to come too. And they immediately followed him, and leaving the boat and their father behind. So when we read this from Matthew's perspective, here's what it looks like. And this is maybe the way some of you grew up thinking about this moment, that Jesus just kind of randomly shows up on the scene. They don't really know who he is, but he says, follow me, and they're like, okay. I mean, we don't really know who you are. We don't know what you're about, but good luck with the fishing business, Dad. Tell Mom we said bye, and they just go and follow him. That's what it appears to be in Matthew's account. It appears that they were somewhat impulsive, maybe even irresponsible in accepting the invitation to follow Jesus. But a lot of us grew up thinking that's how it works, that Jesus says, follow me, and there's really no room for questions, and there's really no opportunity to explore. You're either in or you're out, right? You go one way or the other. Just, I mean, if you want to go to heaven, you better say yes. And so we had this idea that it was just this blind decision to say, I'm going to follow Jesus, but there was not any exploration. There wasn't any room for questioning. But Luke writes the same story, tells us the same story, but he gives us a lot of details leading up to it. Because while Matthew wrote to a Jewish audience, Luke wrote to a Gentile audience. And he knows that the Gentiles are going to be skeptical. They don't understand the rabbinical approach to teaching, where the followers would leave behind their life as they knew it and follow a rabbi and learn from the rabbi. The Gentiles didn't get that. So they were going to have more questions. They were going to be more cynical. And so Luke explains, and in fact, he begins his account, his gospel account in Luke chapter 1, by saying, you know, that essentially he knows his readers are going to be a little bit cynical. He says, many people have set out, this is verse 1, many people have set out to write accounts about the events that have been fulfilled among us, and they use the eyewitness reports circulating among us from the early disciples. Having carefully investigated everything from the beginning, I also have decided to write a careful account, an orderly account for you, most honorable Theophilus, so that you can be certain of the truth of everything you were taught. So what's Luke saying? He's saying, look, I've explored these things. I didn't just write down what other people told me to write down. I heard what they said, first person experience, and then I investigated it carefully, and I've written them down in an orderly manner. And he knows that the people he is going to be writing to are going to be coming at it with some cynicism. And so Luke's going to tell us the same story about Jesus calling the disciples, but he's going to give us context. He's going to help lead us into it. And so before telling us about the calling of the disciples in Luke 5, Luke tells us in chapter 4, verse 14, that Jesus has already been teaching in the area. It says, reports about Jesus spread quickly through the whole region. He taught regularly in their synagogues, was praised by everyone. So Luke makes the point that before Jesus even calls the disciples would have known who he was. They would have been familiar with the reputation of this unconventional rabbi that was an incredible teacher. Luke also tells us in chapter 4 that before Jesus calls the disciples, that he casts out a demon. And verse 36 says, "Amazed, the people exclaimed, 'What authority and power this man's word possesses. Even evil spirits obey him, and they flee at his command.' And the news about Jesus spread through every village in the entire region." So the disciples knew that Jesus had incredible authority, incredible power, that even demons believed or obeyed him. And so before setting out on this adventure with Jesus, they had an opportunity to explore who Jesus was, what he was about. Chapter 4 ends and says, "So Jesus continued to travel around, preaching in synagogues throughout Judea." So here's what I want you to catch, is that sometimes the journey of faith is described as kind of a path where there's no room for questions. You just have to blindly follow. And if you have doubts, you better keep those to yourself. And if you have questions, then, you know, don't ask those out loud. Just get in line and just follow. Sometimes it's portrayed that way, but Luke shows us something different, and John does as well, that when Jesus called the disciples, he gave them opportunity to explore. In fact, in the Gospel of John, the invitation of Jesus is to come and see. Come and see. Come see for yourself. Investigate. Explore this. And so in chapter 5, Luke's going to tell us the same story as Matthew, but he's going to give us a little bit more detail. It's not contradictory, but it's a little more in depth. So here's what Luke says, chapter 5. It says, "One day, Jesus was preaching on the shore of the Sea of Galilee." So Matthew said Jesus was on the shore of the Sea of Galilee. Luke says, yeah, and he was also preaching. Matthew left that out. "Great crowds pressed in on him and to listen to the word of God. And Jesus noticed two empty boats at the water's edge, for the fishermen had left them and were washing their nets. And stepping into one of the boats, Jesus asked Simon, its owner, to push out into the water. And so he sat in the boat and he taught the crowds from there." The water was a way to naturally amplify the voice of Jesus as he taught. And so you kind of picture the scene. You got Jesus in a boat with Peter and probably Peter's brother Andrew, and they're sitting there watching Jesus as he teaches the crowd on the shore. When he had finished speaking, he said to Simon, "Now I want you to go where it is deeper and let down your nets to catch some fish." Verse 5, "Master," Simon replied, we worked all night and we didn't catch anything." You hear what he's saying? We've already done this. We've already tried to catch fish. And by the way, you're a carpenter and I'm a fisherman. Like, that's what it says on my business card. I know what I'm doing. I've been doing this my whole life. I know how to fish. You're telling me to go out and fish, but I've already been fit. This isn't the time of day to fish. That's not the place you want to go fish. And yet he says to Jesus, "But because you say so, I'll do it. I'll let down the nets again." Verse 6 says, "At this time, their nets were so full of fish, they began to tear, and a shout for help brought their partners in the other boat, and soon both boats were filled with fish and on the verge of sinking. When Simon Peter realized what had happened, he fell to his knees before Jesus and said, 'Oh Lord, please leave me. I'm too much of a sinner to be around you.' For he was awestruck by the number of fish that they had caught, as were the others with him. His partners, James and John, the sons of Zebedee, were also amazed. And Jesus replied to Simon, to Peter, 'Don't be afraid. From now on, you'll be fishing for people.' And as soon as they landed, they left everything and they followed Jesus." So do you see the difference between Matthew's account and Luke's account? I mean, what Matthew said was technically right, but what Luke includes makes a lot more sense for those of us who tend to be a little more skeptical. That the disciples had time to explore, to learn, to discover. They had time to personally encounter the power of Jesus in their life. And then they took that next step and they left their nets, they followed him. So as we begin this new year, the question I would like all of us to kind of engage is this question of, what is my next step in my journey with Jesus? What's the next step for me? And for each of us, there's an answer to that question, right? Like, no matter where you're at in your faith journey, there's a next step that needs to be taken. And so one of the things that we discover is that as we follow Jesus, It calls us to continually have this identity as an explorer. No matter where you're at in your faith, there should be an exploration of faith. Exploring involves, we see, learning, and it involves discovery. So you see this with the disciples early on, and that continues to be true throughout following Jesus. Peter and the disciples, they listened to the teaching of Jesus. They had time to discover what he was about, and they personally encountered his truth. And so when Jesus asked to teach from Peter's boat, Peter explored. He didn't say, well, you know, it's not really a good time for me right now, and I'm really tired, and there's a big game on tonight, so I'm going to have to pass on this. No, he took an opportunity to discover a little bit more, to explore if Jesus really knew what he was talking about. And so this is a step that I really would love to challenge some of you to take. I know that I'm talking to some people, at least, that have been coming to church for a little while, and you've learned a little bit about Jesus, and yet there are these questions that you have that are holding you back spiritually. You're struggling with these questions, and they're good questions, but you don't feel like you can ask them. Questions like, you know, how do you reconcile the goodness of God with the suffering in this world? How do you reconcile a loving God with the doctrine of hell? It's good questions. Questions, you know, that maybe have come to the surface since you went away to school and you had some professor who raised a lot of doubts in your faith. And those questions are there, but instead of asking them, instead of feeling free to explore those questions, you hide behind them. In some ways, you're afraid of an answer, because if those questions get answered, then suddenly there are very real implications for your life and for your purpose. And it's almost easier. It's almost easier to not know the answer to the questions, to not actually explore. It's almost easier to just say, well, I believe, but you know, there's all these questions I have, and I'm just going to kind of hide behind these questions. It's more comfortable behind those questions. But the invitation is to explore, to take the next step. And one of the things that I've discovered over the years is that people will hide behind these questions, and then they don't either feel free to explore or they don't want to explore. And so I might say to someone who has a question about faith, it's a good question, I'll say, hey, you know, good question. I'd love for you to take a look at a couple of books, and I might recommend a book or two for them to read. Or I might say, hey, here's a lecture that you might want to listen to, or here's a debate on YouTube that you might want to pull up. And what I've discovered is that more times than not, that never happens. Like, I'll run into the person later, hey, did you read the books? No. Did you take some time? I'd love to hear your observation about what you read. It's been really busy. I just haven't had time. I'm going to pick those up, but I haven't yet. Okay, well, what about the lecture? Did you have time to listen to the lecture, the YouTube video, that debate that I sent you? You know what? I haven't had time to watch that YouTube debate. I've watched the evolution of dance 75 times, but I haven't had time to actually watch that YouTube debate. And so what happens is we act like we have these big questions and these big doubts, but we don't want to explore. Maybe because we're afraid of what we'll find, maybe because we don't feel like we have the freedom to ask the questions, but my challenge for you is to take that next step. Don't hide behind those. Jesus welcomes them. He's not afraid of them. When the disciple Thomas questioned the resurrection of Christ, Jesus didn't say, you know, Thomas, you just have to believe. No, he invited Thomas to examine himself. He said, look, Thomas, put your hand on my hands, feel my scars, and put your hand in my side. And then he said to Thomas, you know, stop doubting and believe. But this is not just a step for people who are kind of at the beginning of their faith journey. This is also a step for those of you who've been a follower of Jesus for many years, that exploring should be a continued commitment that we make. My dad was a seminary professor and a seminary president for more than 30 years. And for the last 10 years or so, he's been the preacher pastor of a church in Evansville, Indiana. But last week, he sent me an email, and he was excited to tell me about some things that God had been teaching him. And I just want to read to you what he wrote to me. He said, son, I have to tell you about a book I just read called Unoffendable. It makes the point that Jesus was never personally offended, and this is something I have completely overlooked and I've really needed to think about. Now, when I'm reading this, almost immediately what strikes me is my dad is one of the least offendable people I know. It's very difficult to offend my father, and yet this is an area where he feels like God is teaching me, and he goes on to say, he says, for all of my life I've been offended by a particular kind of person. The person who bullies others, who torments the helpless, the person who intimidates those who are weak, the person who victimizes the defenseless. As you know, when it comes to people like this, I'm looking for a fight. I'm afraid this is something that I've passed on to you, but I can see now that I have shown very little grace to this type of person. I have too often behaved, he writes, like Peter in the garden, and with noble intentions, I pull out the sword and I take off an ear, determined that I'm going to set things right and I'm going to fix things. And yet Jesus took time to tenderly reattach the ear. And so God has been teaching me, and I feel very free and at peace, that God can be trusted to set things right. I am beginning to understand Romans 12:19, where God says, "It's mine to avenge and I will repay." So God is teaching me that more often I need to back off, put away my sword, and stay out of his business. As I grow older, he writes, I am determined to show more love, patience, and grace in the face of offense and injustice. So he's been a theology professor and preacher for 40 years. But I can tell you one of his favorite things to do is explore, to learn and discover the new things God has to teach him. The Hebrew writer rebukes Christians who follow Jesus for a long time, but don't go deeper. Hebrews 5:12 says, you've been believers so long now that you ought to be teaching others. Instead, you need someone to teach you again just the basic things about God's word. You're like babies who need milk and cannot eat solid food. You're like babies. You want other people to spoon feed you. You've been at this long enough. You should be thinking of ways to pour into other people, but you keep wanting other people to feed you, and you're stuck in the spiritual rut, and it's time you take the next step. One of the things that you find in Scripture when it talks about spiritual growth is that, and this is vital, is that community is always assumed, meaning that we oftentimes will think of ourselves exploring like an Indiana Jones approach, where we're on our own and we're making it happen. And yet in Scripture, that's not consistent. What we see in Scripture is that it's always done in community, that we are on this path together. Doesn't mean we don't do some things on our own, but that we are together. And we encourage one another. We strengthen one another. Dave talked last week about the importance of accountability as we make New Year's resolutions, that they should be measurable and we need some accountability. And so earlier in the week, we had lunch. Dave and I had lunch, and I knew we both have this common vice, this common bad habit that we've both tried to kick over the years, and that is at night, we end every evening with a bowl of cereal. Every night. We've done it for years and years and years. A bowl of cereal before we're going to bed at night. And we're not eating Fiber One, y'all. Like, that's not what we're eating. We're having sugar, kids' cereal. That's how we finish off our night. And I was telling him, hey, I know I need to kick this habit. And but I know there's going to be withdrawal symptoms and such. So I don't want to quit all at once, I explained. And my wife's helping me with this. So she goes out and she buys these bowls that are so small, these really small bowls. And she said, you can eat a bowl of cereal and I just eat it in this bowl instead of this bowl. And I'm like, but it takes two of these bowls. And so I was telling him just about, some of that challenge. And we're kind of in that together. It's a similar struggle. And that night around 10:30 or so, I get a text from Dave with just a simple picture attached of him with his giant bowl of honeycomb. And he's finishing off his night with his big bowl of cereal. And I looked a little closer at this picture and I noticed that he's using almond milk. He's drinking honeycomb with almond milk. That's what happens when 54-year-old men eat sugar cereal. They have to use almond milk. You can't milk almonds. I don't know if you understand how that works, but that, I don't know what that is, but that's not milk, right? But maybe those two things cancel each other out. But we have some fun with it. I mean, we encourage each other. We learn not to take some things a little bit too seriously, but that yet there's some accountability, and that's an important part of this journey. that in on this journey of faith that we share some of the challenges and struggles, and we have someone there to help us keep perspective, and it's not something that's to be done alone. We need community. The other thing that we see with the disciples is and with Peter in particular is that exploring entails personal involvement. So that's what happens. It moves from just learning and discovery to getting personally involved, and Jesus asks Peter to go out into the deep water and to cast his nets. Now suddenly Peter has a choice to make, right? Because up until this point, he's just an observer. He's just a tourist. He's not an explorer. He's just sitting back and listening and watching, but now suddenly he's invited to be a part of the story, to put away his maps and to be a part of the story. Jesus wants to get in his boat, and now he's asking Peter to go out into the deep water. And Peter, frankly, is a little bit cynical. I mean, he's a little bit skeptical when Jesus says, I want us to go fishing, and here's where I want us to go, because in Peter's mind, it's not the right time of day, and this isn't the right place. It's not where we go fish. But Jesus says, look, you know, I know you've done this many, many times your way. I want you to do it my way. And Peter, I don't think Peter thinks it'll work, but he just says, okay, because you say so, I'll do it. At this point, he knows enough about Jesus to know, might as well try it. I mean, after all, what's he have to lose? He doesn't have any fish. It hasn't worked out for him, so why not try it? And so what we see, and this is really significant, he takes this one small area of his life, and he just kind of surrenders it over and says, well, okay, let's see what happens. Let's see what happens. I'm skeptical, frankly. I don't think it's going to make any difference. But okay, I'll explore this. So we'll try it. Because you say so, I'll try it. And I would love for some of you to kind of accept that challenge in an area of your life where you've listened to Jesus and you're still a little skeptical maybe about some things, but you've got this area of your life that's not really working out that well for you. What if this year you just said, I don't really think his way is going to work either, but because he said so and because I don't really have anything to lose, I'll try it. So maybe what Jesus is telling you to do is kind of a next step, personal involvement, is to pray for your enemies. You don't want to do that. It sounds ridiculous, frankly. But the truth is your bitterness and your anger, it's not really working for you. And so what do you have to lose? Why not just try it? Why not just try it and see what happens? Or maybe it's this area of your life, finances, or maybe it's an area of your life, sexuality, and you know things are broken, and you've tried to kind of put things back together on your own, but it's not really working. So why not just say, okay, for this year, I don't really believe all of this. I don't really think it's going to work, but because he said so, I'll throw my nets out there. I'll explore. I'll see what happens. Or maybe it's in your marriage. You feel like you've been working really hard in your marriage, but there's not a lot to show for it, and things don't seem that much better now than they did last year, even though you've been putting in the effort. And so you say, okay, I'm skeptical that it'll work or make that much difference, but I'll explore here. I'll try it. And I'll see what happens if I just simply start praying with my wife. I'll see what happens if I just try to find some ways to love her sacrificially throughout the week. If I speak to her with gentleness. Now, I don't think it'll work. I think she's just going to run right over me, but because Jesus has said this, maybe I'll try it. Maybe I'll try just to encourage my husband every day. I don't feel like it, to be honest with you, but if Jesus said that, I'll try it. Or maybe you say, I'll try to talk to my husband with respect. Frankly, I don't think he deserves it. If he would do something worthy of respect, I'd show him respect, but all right, because the Bible tells me to do this, I'll try it and I'll see if it makes any difference. I don't think it'll make any difference. And so you just say, okay, God, I'm going to explore your truth in this area of my life, and I'm going to see what happens. Jesus seems to welcome that. And so the question is, are you going to be a tourist? Or are you going to be an explorer? Are you going to be someone who stares at maps and is more interested in taking pictures? Are you going to be someone who just stays on the trail? A tourist demands to be entertained and wants to be waited on. Are you going to be a tourist or are you going to be an explorer? If you're beginning this year in a coffee shop, staring at maps, saying, someday I'll go there, then we are inviting you on an adventure. Some of us grew up in church where the idea of following Jesus was kind of captured by this sentence, won't you invite Jesus into your life? That's how a lot of us thought of our faith journey. That's the invitation many of you responded to. Someone stood up and said, hey, we want to challenge you to invite Jesus into your life. And you thought, all right, you know, I'm not sure. Maybe I have some questions. Maybe I have some doubts. But I want to go to heaven, so I'm going to invite Jesus into my life. And that's not the invitation. Jesus doesn't want to be invited into your life. Because, you know, frankly, your life is kind of boring. And it's a little bit messy. The invitation is not to invite Jesus into your life. Like Peter didn't say, all right, Jesus, I feel like I know you well enough that I want to invite you into my life and we can fish together. I'll teach you how to clean the fish and fix the nets and we'll sell them at market. It'll be good. It'll be a good life. Jesus, that's all right. It's not being invited, Jesus being invited into our lives. Instead, the invitation is an invitation to go on an adventure with Jesus, to leave your life behind and join him in his work. That's the invitation. And so we want to ask you, we want to challenge you over these next 4 weeks, not so much to invite Jesus into your life, but to join him in his life, to leave behind your old life, and to take the next step in following him in the adventure that he has for you. Let's pray together. God, I thank you for inviting us to come along with you. And I know that there are some people in this room who are just kind of checking things out, and they're a little bit skeptical and cynical. And God, I pray that you would let them know that's okay. It's okay. You're not intimidated by that. That their questions are welcome, and you want them to explore. God, I know there are others in this room who have studied a lot of maps, and they've learned a lot about you. They've sat and listened to you, but now you're calling them into some deeper water. You're asking them to be personally involved. That's a whole different level. And so, God, I pray that you would just allow them, maybe even right now in their mind, to identify an area of their life that they're going to explore. They're just going to find out, Jesus, what it looks like to surrender that area to you. And so help them to take that step. And I know, God, there's others who've done that, and they're at a place where it's time to just leave behind their nets, to surrender their life, and to follow after you wholeheartedly. But God, would you help each of us to take the next step in our adventure of faith? It's in Jesus' name we pray. Amen. So we want to give you an opportunity to do that. We want to give you a chance in the next few moments that if you want to talk to someone about accepting the invitation of Jesus to join him, what it means to put your trust in him and surrender your life to him. You can meet me down front. We'd love to talk to you about that decision. Or maybe you're ready to become a part of this church family. As I said, community is assumed that we need to be on this adventure together. We'd love to give you a chance to make that decision as well. Again, you can meet me down front. Let's stand and let's worship our great God.